Okay, now we're looking at non-modifiable risk factors. This is an important section for you and I to remember, because this is where we can help patients become healthier. So don't look at this like, just a victim, nothing I can do if I have this risk factor. No, no, it's a clue. It's letting you know if you have this non-modifiable risk factor, meaning it's not anything you can do to change it, then it just helps you be aware that this is an area you need to be extra sharp and on guard for. So I'm going to give you several non-modifiable risk factors. As a nurse, you're going to know these populations have increased risk. As an educator, as a nurse, you're going to make sure that patients are aware of this and know that it's really important that they make some healthy lifestyle changes. First one is ethnicity. Now, certain ethnic groups have a higher risk or incidence of atherosclerosis. If a patient or you has a family history of atherosclerosis, pay attention, because that means that you also have likely or a higher risk for atherosclerosis. Now, as we age and what your gender is, that means that you have a higher likelihood of having atherosclerosis. So I'm worried about a higher level of atherosclerosis in a 70-year-old than I am the average 20-year-old. Okay, so there's the first three. Now, what's important about these? They're non-modifiable, but it doesn't make you or your patients a victim. They're just heads-up signals to let you know you need to be really aware of making healthier lifestyle changes. So ethnicity, family history, and as we age and your gender. Now, high blood pressure is something we can do about. So we've got 9 modifiable risk factors. Let's get down to business. These are things that if we can help the patient understand that they're empowered to make a difference in these, they can change these. Won't be easy. We may ask someone to make some really difficult choices, but that's our job, to help them make small changes toward better health. All right, high blood pressure. So obviously, your risk for atherosclerosis, high blood pressure makes everything worse, right? That pressure is going to be really intense. If the vessels are already kind of narrowed, this is going to be problematic. Next one, this one starts meddling in people's business. If the patient is a smoker, they might be kind of awkward for them to have a conversation with you about this, because They know there's risk, they know. But this really powerful drug, nicotine, it's so difficult, but it's not impossible to stop. So this is something that you want to have an open conversation with your patient, see where they are on the issue, and we'll give you some ideas and strategies on how you help people make big lifestyle changes. But for now, let's focus on the 9 factors. So you've got high blood pressure, smoking. We think now a theory is if you have elevated LDL cholesterol, that puts you at an increased risk for atherosclerosis, so we'll want to control that. Obesity and what types of food you're eating also play a role. Physical inactivity, so if a patient tends to be sedentary, that increases a risk for atherosclerosis. And stress or substance abuse. Okay, so we're 6 factors in. Pause for just a minute and see how many of those original 3 that we started with you can recall. Okay, good. Sometimes when we're going through a list, it's hard to stay focused and you almost kind of want to check out. Do what it takes to keep your brain in there. Number them as we go through them. Do something that engages with these lists so it helps it stick in your mind. Now, some additional risk factors. These are the last 3. We're going to talk about diabetes. Anybody with diabetes 1 or 2 has a higher level of risk for cardiovascular events and atherosclerosis. So we'll watch them very closely. That's why we want to watch all these other risk factors, including keeping tight blood sugar control. So the tighter the control we can keep on a patient's blood sugar through their diet, exercise, and medications as appropriate, they're going to have a lower risk for atherosclerosis. That's why it's important for blood sugar to keep within a normal range. Now, elevated homocysteine levels, that may be something you're not familiar with, but that's an additional risk factor. Last one is C-reactive protein. Now, is that something you're familiar with? Well, that's a marker or an indicator of inflammation. Now, based on what we've talked about, why do we want to minimize inflammation? Right, because that was an important piece of the puzzle. When you have the damage to the endothelial lining, then you have the responders, right, those fatty things, and inflammatory mediators. Right. So if a patient has elevated C-reactive protein, we assume that they've got extra inflammation going on in their body. That puts them at an even higher risk.